So in this video, we're going to take some time to discuss properties of determinants. So properties of determinants, we've already looked at in the previous homework how to calculate determinants. We've defined how to calculate a determinant in terms of row or column expansions of the row or column elements times their cofactor matrices. These three properties of determinants are really talking about how the elementary row operations impact the value of a determinant. Remember, we learned the elementary row operations at the very start of the course when we were learning how to put matrices into reduced row echelon form using elementary row operations. So the first claim is that if you have a matrix B that you obtain from a matrix A, by multiplying any row or column by a scalar C, then the determinant of B is C times the determinant of A. So again, this is multiplying a row or column by a scalar is one of the three elementary row operations. So what we identify is that the determinant of B will be C times the determinant of A. If B is obtained from A by interchanging, switching two rows or two columns, then the determinant of B will be the opposite of the determinant of A. So again, interchanging rows or columns was one of our three elementary row operations. And if B is obtained from A by adding a multiple of one row or column to another row or column, then the determinant of A is the determinant of B. So the third elementary row operation doesn't change the value of the determinant. So proving number one is relatively easy. So if we were trying to prove property number one, what we would do is just say, hey, what does the determinant of C, a scalar C times a matrix A look like? And then we would just need to remember how a determinant is defined. And the proof for row, would be the same as the proof for column. You would pick an arbitrary row, and then the process that you go through would be the identical for column. So kind of you could say without loss of generality, just calculate the determinant of C times A. Well, that would be, you'd get C times the element, if we're working in row K, if we expand with respect to row K, you'd have the row K column 1 element would be multiplied by the scalar C. And then to get the determinant, you would have to multiply that by the cofactor matrix for row K column 1, plus C would get distributed into, in A, element, the element in row K column 2, and then you would multiply by the cofactor matrix for row K column 2, plus blah blah blah, plus. And if, and remember, A has to be a square by a square matrix, n by n square matrix. So you would keep doing this until you got all the way down to the element in row k column n. That would be the last column, and you would multiply by the cofactor matrix for row k column n. And if you look at this, the scalar C shows up across the entire summation, so you could factor it out, and that would leave you with the element from A, row k column 1 times the cofactor matrix for row k column 1 plus, and then you'd get A, the element from row k column 2 times the cofactor matrix from row k column 2 plus blah blah blah, all the way down to the element from row k column n times the cofactor matrix from column n. And then you should recall or recognize from the previous homework assignment that this calculation here is how you would calculate the determinant of A. So you get a scalar times the determinant of A, and that proves the result. If for the for rows and for columns, we would just do the same thing. We could say by similar argument, the only thing that would change is you'd pick column K instead of row K. So this numbering convention here on the subscripts, you'd swap everything, but the argument would run through the same way. So we would probably just say by similar argument, if we pick an arbitrary column, the proof plays out the same way. The proof of the other two properties isn't nearly as easy. Some of the more elegant proofs I've seen involve something called permutations, which I think everybody in this class has seen permutations in discrete math, but we haven't seen permutations applied in a matrix context, so those types of proofs would be inaccessible to us in this class. But here's what I would encourage you to do, especially for the math majors in the class. And computer science majors too, you ought to do this just as an academic. As an academic, you should want to know why these properties hold. So what I would encourage you to do would be two things. One, prove those two properties to yourselves, at least in the context of 2x2 matrices, because the proofs of property 2 and 3 for 2x2 matrices, maybe I'll make this a homework assignment, because this would be a great homework assignment. But the properties for 2x2 matrices would be fairly easy to prove, very straightforward proof if we just had to work with a 2x2 matrix and not have to worry about a general matrix. So that would be the first thing I'd say. Explore it at least in the context of 2x2 matrices where the determinant definition is very simple. The second thing I would encourage you to do, because I think everybody in this class as a math or computer science major has taken a discrete math course. And in discrete math, one of the proof techniques that you used was proof by induction, where you prove something in the simplest possible case, and then you assume that it holds in for some advanced case, for the nth case or the kth case, and then you use that assumption to show that it must hold in the k plus first case. So something to think about would be this. And I haven't tried actually to prove it this way, but I was just thinking about it tonight, actually trying to think about what would be some ways for you as students of mathematics and computer science to kind of explore these two properties. What would an induction proof look like for this? It would look like, hey, let's prove it for the case of 2x2 matrices, the simplest possible case. Which we could do for properties 2 and 3. It'd be easy to prove that those two results hold for the 2x2 case. And then what would happen if you assume that it holds for the n by n case, and then try to prove, given that assumption, that it holds for the n plus 1 by n plus first square matrix? So that would be something I think that would be worthwhile to explore. But bottom line is, key takeaways here, we've got three properties that identify how elementary row operations impact calculations of determinants. We'll be able to use these properties to simplify determinant computations by using elementary row operations to introduce zeros into our matrices. And the second key takeaway here is that you should, as maturing students of math and computer science, at a minimum, try to think about why, or prove to yourselves why, these two properties must hold at least in the case of 2x2 matrices.